McGraw-Hill Professional presents Every Job is a Sales Job, How to Use the Art of Selling to Win at Work, written and narrated by Dr. Cindy McGovern. This is for everybody who's ever said, but I'm not a salesperson. I hope this book will convince you that using the skills of the sales professional, no matter what your job or job title, will help make you more successful at work and at life. Introduction. I have three important truths to share with you. First, you are a salesperson. Everyone is, like it or not. Second, you should be selling, at least unofficially, all the time. And third, selling, even unofficially, will help your career and company. Here's how I know that. I'm a born college professor. Or I was. Or I thought I was. I'm not anymore. I am a former college professor. Turns out, I'm a born salesperson. Turns out, I'm pretty good at convincing people to do what I ask them to do. I'm persuasive, I know what I want, and I'm passionate about getting it. That passion, when coupled with what my grandma called my gift of gab, and my naturally outgoing nature, seem to be contagious. If I really, really believe in something, I often can infect others with that same energy and confidence. And then, they want to help me. Or give something to me, or work with me, or be my friend. It's a gift, I know, and I'm grateful for it, because it has helped me live my best life, both career-wise and personally. This gift, this energy and confidence, helped me change my career path from college professor to sales consultant. It eventually led me to embrace my inner entrepreneur and open a business to help people who aren't born salespeople, and who probably don't even want to be salespeople, learn how to sell and be more successful. But I never, ever would have called myself a salesperson when I was a college professor. Yet, without realizing it, I sold all day long. Guess what? So do you. No matter what you do for work, no matter if you're outgoing like me, or a little shy, or even an introvert. That's an important revelation, because no matter what job you're in, college professor, lawyer, Uber driver, maintenance engineer, receptionist, coder, or anything else, you have to sell stuff. You might not think so. You might not realize it, but you do every day, every single day. As a professor, I had to sell my students on coming to class and turning in their assignments on time. As a lawyer, you have to sell clients on accepting plea deals and juries on finding your clients not guilty. As a maintenance specialist, you have to sell your company's decision makers on upgrading the equipment you need to do a good job and the people you work with on using that equipment properly. As a receptionist, you have to sell the people who walk up to your desk or call your office that you and your company are friendly and value their business. As a coder, you have to sell your colleagues or clients on approving your web page designs and taking your advice. As a manager, you have to sell your team on working together to reach a common goal. Regardless of your job title, you have to sort of unconsciously sell people every day on believing that you're competent, deserving of their trust in future business, reliable, and nice to work with. You have to, just by the way you talk and behave, sell the customers you meet every day to believe that your company is a good one to do business with. All day long, you sell your ideas, you sell your company, you sell yourself. Let me tell you about my own epiphany. It's the moment that led me to where I am today. When I applied for my first non-academic job after working as a college professor of communication for 4 years, I answered an ad for a consultant who would advise businesses that specialized in insurance. I'd never been a consultant, and I knew nothing about insurance except how to buy it for my car. My first interview was by phone, another first for me. During my conversation with a woman named Laura, I learned that the title of the job was actually sales management consultant. Oops, I'd never done sales either. Three strikes so far. But as far as management, I knew I could do it. I also knew I was pretty good at convincing people to do stuff, the administrators at my college, my students, my friends. So I figured if I could get an in-person interview, I'd be gold. I set out on a mission to convince Laura over the phone to call me in for a second interview, this time in person. I knew that if I could look her in the eye, I could convince her that I was coachable and teachable and that I could do this job. I knew that if I could meet her in person, she would see my passion. I drew on all the communication techniques that I learned in graduate school and that I had taught my college students. I mirrored her language, her speech patterns. I exercised active listening. I made a connection with her. I got the second interview, and guess what? I got the job. I didn't know it at the time, but the process I used is the same one that the most successful professional salespeople use to sell stuff. They do their homework and plan for the transaction. They look for their opportunity. They establish trust with the person they're dealing with. They ask for what they want, and they follow up after they have their answer. I didn't realize that's what I was doing, but it turns out Laura did. She recognized my ability to sell, and she knew I could do the job. She knew something about me that I didn't know. She knew I was a salesperson. And after she hired me, she helped me embrace my inner salesperson at a time when I still believed that all sales were cheesy. In fact, it never occurred to me until about 6 months later when my boss at the same consulting firm moved me, kicking and screaming, from consultant to salesperson that I was onto something big. I had realized the skills I used to get into that company are the same tactics that sales professionals use every day to sell their company's products and services to potential clients. That was an aha moment that eventually convinced me to write this book. I had sold myself to Laura over the phone and to Laura's boss once I met him in person. I sold him on my potential, even though I was far less than experienced in consulting and sales. I realized selling isn't something that only professional salespeople do. It's something all professionals do. Selling is what I've always done every time I had to convince somebody to give me what I wanted or needed. I was selling all day long, on and off the job, but I never put that label on it. You haven't either, right? Call it what you want, it's still sales. The biggest thunderbolt struck me when I realized that everyone is a salesperson nearly every day, no matter what the job title is. The cashier at a sandwich shop sells customers on adding a soda and chips to their order. The mechanic at the car dealership sells drivers on paying to have their tires rotated so they'll last longer. The Civic Association president sells neighbors on spending a beautiful Saturday morning indoors at a meeting so they can vote on some new rules. The radio talk show host sells listeners on staying tuned until after the commercial break. Computer technicians at the help desk of a big box store sell customers on buying their next electronic device at that same store by treating them and their problems as important and never talking down to them. It's like this phenomenon called blue car syndrome. Once you see something, or in this case, realize something, you see it everywhere. Like if you buy a blue car, then all of a sudden you notice that blue cars are everywhere. Sorry, didn't mean to get all college professory. Guess I'm still a little bit of a nerd at heart. So we all know this now. You sell, even if it's not an official part of your job. But how do you do this newfound job better than you are right now? By working through the steps of every job as a sales job. Did I just hear you say ick? I know. I used to feel that way about sales too. But you can stop kicking and screaming. My five-step sales formula for people who are not sales professionals is in no way, shape, or form pushy, cheesy, high pressure, or unethical. It's more give and take. It's more like, what can I do for you and what can you do for me? My formula will show you how to sell in a nice way. I play nice when I sell. I always play nice. So I won't ask you to do anything but be yourself and respect the people you work with. This five-step process will come in handy when you find yourself faced with an opportunity to sell. It's a sort of blueprint for using the skills of the sales professional to get referrals, retain clients, impress visitors, influence your boss, or otherwise sell someone on yourself and your company. My formula will come in handy whether you're a freelancer, contractor, teacher, or construction worker. You'll use it if you're an employee, manager, executive, or business owner. For managers, it will help you create a culture at work that encourages non-sales employees to bring in new business and rewards them when they do. The fact is that anyone who has a job, any job, sells or should sell. Even those whose work titles do not include the word sales, even those who'd rather be unemployed than accept a sales job, are selling, or should be and could be, every day. If they're not, they're not doing their best work. Every job as a sales job has two goals. One, to convince you that everyone who works sells, like it or not, including you. Two, to teach you how to sell successfully, even though you don't work in an official capacity as a salesperson. This is the book that I wish someone had given me when I made the transition from college professor to consultant to sales professional early in my career. To be honest, I wish someone had given me this book before I even accepted my first job out of college as a professor of communication. I know now that I was selling students, administrators, other faculty, and even office managers every time I needed a signature on a form, permission to attend a conference, or a better effort on an undergraduate assignment. But I didn't realize it then. If I had, I would have done way more of it. If I had had this book way back then, it would have saved me a lot of time figuring it out. The formula. Every job as a sales job is broken into two parts. In part one, I reveal both obvious and hidden opportunities for employees with any job title to attract new business, to retain existing customers, and to spot opportunities to sell themselves and their ideas. I will share a secret that inevitably will lead to the aha moment when you realize that you already sell all the time and therefore you already know how to sell. In part two, I will break my process into five steps that show you exactly how to employ the tactics, secrets, and strategies of successful sales pros so you can use them when opportunities to sell yourself or your company arise. The first step is to plan. Here, we will figure out what you really want and plan a way to achieve that. The second step is to look for opportunities to make those sales. The third step is to establish trust with the people who can help you. The critical fourth step is to ask for what you want. And finally, the fifth step is to follow up, no matter if the answer was yes or no, to maintain relationships and to pay it forward. Through these five steps and the lessons taught throughout this book, I will convince you that getting is indelibly intertwined with giving. And perhaps most importantly, I'll help you to overcome the learned limitation of fear when it comes to asking for what you want, need, and deserve. I will also address what I like to call the ick factor of sales. My guess is you would rather do without than do anything that resembles sales. I was just like that too until I discovered a kinder, lighter touch style of sales based on clarity, listening, mutual benefit, and gratitude. That is what I introduce in every job as a sales job. If you're like most people, you are reluctant to ask for what you want. You might not even believe you deserve it. So you rarely ever ask for what you want or for what you deserve. The fact is that employees who ask a customer or a potential client, a friend, a colleague, or anyone else to do business with a company, to buy something, or to do anything really, are exponentially more likely to hear a yes than if they don't ask. Likewise, someone who's brave enough to ask for a job or a raise is more likely to get it. There's simply no reason why you should settle for what's offered if you believe you deserve more. Whether it's a higher salary, a vacation, a great work schedule, or a job, you deserve more. And if you don't think you deserve more, I hope to convince you that you do, in fact, deserve more. I'm going to help you to overcome the fear of rejection that might be preventing you from asking for what you want, need, and deserve. Maybe you just don't know how to ask. Or perhaps it doesn't even occur to you that you should or can ask. By the time you finish reading Every Job is a Sales Job, you will. You will know how to use proven sales strategies to come out on top during every one of the constant interactions, which are really transactions, that any employee of any company makes throughout the day. Every Job is a Sales Job will lay out a formula for turning that nice doing business with you handshake into a request for future business in a way that is fair to both giver and receiver, and that is comfortable even for those who are shy or lack confidence. And it will fire you up to do that without resorting to cheesy, pushy tactics so often associated with used car sales or timeshares. But frankly, even those salespeople are moving away from those tactics. This brings to mind the signs I used to see at every restaurant, gas station, and store that said, "Come again." We should do that every time we meet with people. Invite them to come back. Don't assume that your excellent service speaks for itself and that your client or customer will automatically come back for more. Instead, come right out and ask for what you want. Part 1. I didn't expect this. Chapter 1. So you're not in sales? A few years back, I was living in Washington, D.C., the first 95-degree day that summer was also the first day that season that broke 80 degrees. We'd had a long winter and an unseasonably cool spring, so even by mid-June, I'd never cranked up the air conditioning in the row house where I was living with my husband. When I did flip the thermostat on to turn on the air conditioning for the first time on that sweltering day, nothing happened. By the time a few hours had gone by, the house was unbearably hot. I called for help. The technician who came over was friendly and courteous. He covered his dusty work boots with what my grandma used to call footies, the footwear equivalent of a shower cap, so he wouldn't track dirt on my clean carpet. He made polite conversation with me. He listened carefully as I described the problem I was having with the AC. He checked out the thermostat, asked where he could find the outdoor condenser, and crawled into the attic to examine the ductwork. He explained the problem to me, gave me a couple of options with prices, and asked if I had any questions. I'm a chatty person, so along the way, I had told him my gas furnace had leaked all winter, but thankfully had never shut down. I said I guessed it wasn't my year for smooth sailing with appliances. We agreed that he would replace the air conditioner's motor the following week. Then he asked me something I didn't expect. Could he see my gas furnace? I took him to the utility closet and showed him the water stain on the floor. He gave the unit a careful once-over and told me why the furnace had leaked and what he could do to solve the problem. We agreed that he would do that repair the following week, too. He left my home with two pricey jobs to complete the next week. Why? He saw an opportunity to sell me a furnace repair while the actual job was just to service my air conditioner. The tech, Ben, isn't a salesperson. He's a highly skilled HVAC technician. He doesn't get a commission for adding a furnace job onto an AC service call. He isn't responsible for bringing extra business into the company. Nobody told him that he should look at the furnace. It was summertime, and he was there to solve an air conditioning problem, period. But he sold me nonetheless. Ben probably wouldn't even call that a sale. He'd call it a common courtesy, or maybe a chance to help a customer out, or just doing a good job. He's just a nice guy who heard me say I had a problem, and he knew how to solve it. So he offered, and I accepted. Call it what you want, but I call that a sale. The company wins, Ben wins, I win. Just because your job title doesn't include the word sales doesn't mean you can't or shouldn't sell. My advice? You should sell. And sell as often as possible. Selling is everybody's job. Without sales, none of us would have a job to come to tomorrow. Who should sell? Everyone who meets other people as part of his or her routine duties is in the perfect position to sell additional products and services to those people. They could be customers or clients. They could be visitors to the company headquarters. They could be the neighbors or friends you talk to about work after hours. I can almost hear you saying, "But sales is not my job." Isn't it, though? Whether you're the president of the company or a member of the cleaning crew, if you come in contact with people, the public, your colleagues, or anyone really, during your workday, you have a chance to sell. If you're well-dressed, pleasant to be around, good at making small talk, and interested in hearing what people have to say, you can sell. If you're quiet, but you're a good listener, even if you're shy, you can sell. If you have a skill that you can use to solve problems for other people, you can sell. In fact, you already do. Every time you make a good impression on anybody you meet in conjunction with your job, that person becomes more likely to use your company again the next time he or she needs a product or service like the one your company specializes in. That's a potential sale. I knew before Ben ever left my house that day that I was going to call his company again the next time I needed an HVAC tech. In fact, I knew Ben would be my guy every time. I would request him. He made a sale that neither he nor I expected when he first walked through my front door. He also made a customer for life. He made such a good impression that I told all my neighbors about him, and some of them called his company. That's going to add up to lots of extra sales over the years. Chances are good that you've made this kind of unexpected sale too. or that you could have if you had paid closer attention to what your customer was telling you. For example, when you run into a mom at your kid's ball game who asks you where you work, she becomes more likely to call you if she needs something your company offers if you've talked about work in a positive way. That's a potential sale. Of course, the opposite is true as well. If you badmouth your company after hours, you could give people a bad impression of your workplace. That's the opposite of a sale. So whenever you meet an old school pal for lunch, talk enthusiastically about the project you're working on or an opportunity your boss just offered you. That way, you plant the seed that your employer is a good one. Your pal might someday recommend you or your company or apply for a job there himself. That's a sale. Whenever you work with a client or customer and you get an inkling that that person isn't too happy with another company she's using for a service that your firm offers too, you have the opportunity to bring that business on board. Do it, and you've made a sale. Pro tip. In sales lingo, that's called qualifying a client. The simple act of introducing these qualified clients to the real sales pros in your company is as good as bringing money into the business. What kinds of skills do you use when you want to convince the board of directors to approve a new education program for stakeholders? Or wow a client into choosing your creative idea for an ad campaign instead of someone else's? Or get buy-in from your staff when you decide to add Saturday shifts to their traditional weekday-only schedules? Sales skills. None of these tasks is an add-on. None of them is something you would turn over to a sales professional instead of doing it yourself. Yet, you're using the skills of the sales pro every time you make a pitch, a request, or a change that involves other people. You sell, sell, sell all day. But you don't call it sales. You just call it doing your job. Shift the way you think. Now that you understand that you have the potential to sell in unexpected ways, it's time to shift the way you think so you can easily identify sales opportunities going forward. Think about what you've sold at work today and to whom. Did you get a colleague to cover your phone for you so you could take an extra half hour at lunchtime for a physical therapy appointment? Did you convince a caller to hold for an extended time so you could figure out how to fill her unusual request? Did you ask the coworker who sits in the next cubicle to turn down the volume on the music he streams on his computer all day? Did you collect a past due payment from a client whose account's been delinquent for 6 months? How'd you do that? You use the skills of the sales professional. You sold them on it. You didn't even realize you were selling, but you were. A client of mine, Martin, was an insurance underwriter for years and years before his boss promoted him into the position of sales manager. Martin came to me for my advice because my work involves helping non-salespeople excel at sales. "I'm not a salesperson," Martin kept telling me. Even after he became the sales manager, he insisted that he was in management, not sales. It wasn't too long before the sales team he managed outsold every competitor in his market. Martin still refused to call himself a salesperson. I hoped to convince him to embrace his inner sales professional. I asked him why he thought his boss promoted him into this job. "I've been with the company a long time," he replied. My response? Nope. It's because you sold him on it. You sold him on your ability to manage a sales force, even though you're not a trained sales professional. I told him, "You can tell me all day that you're not a salesperson, but you went from a middle manager to the hiring manager to the sales manager. You got there by selling yourself to the higher ups." It took some doing, but I finally convinced Martin that he has been selling every day since he joined the company 10 years ago. He just never realized that's what he was doing. Imagine if he had. Imagine if he had been selling on purpose instead of doing it without realizing it. Imagine how much more successful he might be by now. Martin's passion is helping people. Now that he realizes that he excels as a salesperson, he can help so many more people. Embrace your inner salesperson. Know that your job is sales, even if it's not your title on your business card. Consider every interaction a transaction and every transaction a sale. In the chapters that follow, I'm going to teach you how to do this without resorting to the ick tactics of unscrupulous sales reps. I'm going to remind you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.